Richard Hammond. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
You please, before we go any further, please recount the story you've just told me. I simply asked, where are you going to be for Christmas? It's yes. A nice icebreaker at this time of year. It's the sort of thing your mum rings you up and asks you about in the middle of July.
Well, it is a point that's kind of uppermost in my mind at the moment, because the plan was we were going to go skiing, which, I mean, listening, it might not be a big deal to you, but it's kind of a big deal, because in the Hammond clan, like my whole clan, I don't think a Hammond has been actually skiing for generations, because we're from Birmingham.
It's not your natural climate.
No, skiing is for like James Bond. Real people go camping in the Forest of Dean. That's what actual people do. They don't go skiing. But we thought, no, let's do it. And me and Mindy, my wife, are going to take my two daughters, who are 9 and 6, on their first skiing trip. And everybody says,
fantastic.
Oh, that's the perfect age.
Yeah.
Start them at 9 and 6, and they'll be quicker than you and they'll learn. So that was going to be brilliant. So we had it planned. We booked 6 days. In some, I don't know, somewhere or other.
Where there's snow. Milton Keynes.
Yeah, it could be. Yes. And that was all very exciting. But two things happened. One, my boss off Top Gear, Andy Wilman, lovely, charming man, told me that I had to do the voiceover for our Christmas special. I had to record it on the middle day of that week. Oh, no, that's all right. No, I'll just
so
fly home.
So they already drawn straws and they were like, get Richard to do it. How come the
no,
other two?
No, because we all three have to do it.
Oh, I
see.
Because
it'll be a film with all three of us in that we've made, but it needs the voiceover recording on.
You not do it from the ski resort?
That's what I said.
Phone it in,
apparently not.
No,
apparently
damn.
Not. So I was going to have to fly home and do it. I thought, never mind, I'll just book a flight home, bring myself back and do it, and then go back to the holiday.
Yeah.
And then running in the woods, I twisted my ankle.
Twisted your ankle running in the woods.
So I can't get insured.
Why are you not running? You're
so
in
the holiday,
shape.
The holiday insurers say, we
can
can't
you get
insure.
Insurance anyway? If they if they ring up, they're going to have to transfer you to a supervisor. It's Richard Hammond on the line. What do we do?
It is always a tremendous moment. So the name, Richard Hammond, long pause. Any accidents in the last three? Yes, all right. Yes, there have been.
There must be like,
Well, you know what it's like. It's bad enough with our job anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
they think you're hanging around with George Michael or the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
I mean, you are, obviously.
Yeah,
but in my world, I'm just driving around with Jezza or James in the car, and who cares what happens there? So it's.
So you managed to find someone which would ensure you to go skiing anyway, but then you knack your ankle.
But then I did my ankle, which was, it was a tremendous accident.
So what, were you really running out in the woods? Is this a midlife crisis thing? Because you're 40 next month,
aren't
you?
I'm not making any. I don't know. Why should I hide having a mid. Somebody's, oh, look at you growing your hair. What is it? Midlife crisis. Yes, thank you. I'm 39. Of course it is.
You've got the perfect way to have that midlife crisis on Top Gear. It's a load of other men it's two other men who've been through it.
Ah, well, the thing is that because I'm already doing all the things I'm supposed to do for midlife crisis.
Sorry,
I can't
go
and buy a sports car, can I? I drive them all the time.
That's right.
You see all these blokes in the just approaching 40 buying a little sports car, thinking it'll compensate.
When are you going to grow the ponytail?
Well,
you're working on it.
Well, I used to have really long hair, you see.
Yeah.
So I'm regressing, I'm returning. It's my territory and I'm reclaiming it.
So let's go back to
what will stop me is I get stopped all the time going, are you just copying James May?
Oh, God, no.
So, I mean, that's a worry.
Listen, let's go back to the woods then. So you're by yourself.
Oh, sorry, I wondered what you meant.
Just, that's right. No, let's
you
go
lost
to the
me
woods.
Then, Christian.
It's a game we play with guests.
Yes. Okay.
Let me take you by the hand.
Okay.
Take you into the woods.
It's dark in here.
So you're running by yourself.
Yeah.
Mobile phone with you, I take it?
Well, you see, no. No, just
what?
To make it.
I'm surprised your missus lets you go anywhere without a minder or plastic bubble or
some sort of radar identifier.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, to make it live for you briefly, I was running through the woods on my usual route, which is on the big paths, and it's on top of a hill opposite where I live.
Sounds great.
It was beautiful. And there's a little path to my left that I had never really explored. And I ran past it, and you know how you kind of obsess over
this
things
is an episode
in
Casualty.
I was thinking, I should go up that little path. And then another voice was saying, no, don't just do the normal route. I should go up the little path. No, do the normal. I should go. And I listened to the wrong voice and I went back and went up the little path and I was running along and then it went, you know that moment when you go over and I thought, oh, I've got on a stick because there was a big crack and that was my ankle and then I was, but in the film, what would happen is the hero.
Well, it depends what film we're talking about. Deliverance or?
Yeah, that's the kind of film. The hero, me, obviously, would at that point sort of hobble up on the one leg and then snap off a stick and make
Rainier
a crutch out of it. And
Rambo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. You try getting through all the brambles and spiky bits at the fringe of some woodland on one leg to get a stick to make a crutch. It sounds so easy. Yes, make a crutch out of it. How? When you've only got one leg working. So I did that. Then I hobbled along through the woods, making a bit of a racket by then. And I was squeaking. ow, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And there's only one farm there, so eventually I hobbled up to that and knocked, hello, and the door opened, and the lady came out and said, oh, I've always wanted to meet you. Okay.
Where's your shopping trolley? You could have lent on that as a makeshift crutch.
And her, thank you, yes, if she'd known, she'd have said it. And her very first words after that were, where's your phone? Oh, I haven't got it. So she then drove me home, and my wife's first words, where's your phone? Look all right. And the nurse's first words, well, what, did you have your phone with it? No, clearly didn't have my phone.
So what have you done to your ankle then?
Well, now, you see, there's a lot of speculation. The nurse took one look and said, oh, clearly you've broken that. It's just a case of whether it's a displaced break and you need pins. I can't.
That's what you want to hear. More time in hospital.
I'm
yes, like, please. Yeah.
I'm only out running. I mean, I was running to stave off being 40, and it turns out all my limbs will shatter
you
if I go for a
it.
Run. No. Yeah. So it, basically, it's twisted, I think.
Yeah, but that doesn't sound very manly.
No, it's
does
not.
It? You need
well,
to
then
say
they said that
tendons.
I might have pulled the ligaments off.
Yeah, that
the
sounds
bone.
Better, doesn't it? Like yeah. a sporting yeah. injury, then, isn't it? If you yeah. say I've twisted my ankle, it's a bit
it's
fey,
not good,
isn't
it?
You're a lovey on
it's
TV.
A housemaid's knee, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I'm collecting rubbish ailments. I am because I've had kidney stones. They're not very heroic.
Kidney stones, you're only meant to get them when you're about fit. How do you get those at your age?
I don't know. I've had kidney stones, athlete's foot, that's a puller. Hernia. Oh, yeah.
I've had a double hernia.
Have you?
Yeah.
Right,
yeah,
so you've outdone
yeah,
me hernia.
Yeah,
all right.
I can't do you on the kidney stones.
Now I've twisted my ankle. They're none of them the kind of things you can lean on a park.
Yeah, but you've been in a 300 miles an hour car.
Yeah,
you top everybody.
And not a mark.
I know.
Look at me, there's not a mark on me. Scars are internal. There isn't a mark. You can see it. So when I'm in the pub, oh, yeah, I fell off my scooter. Look at that.
You've got no
savaged
war
by a dog. Look at that. I've got, well, you can see my belly button where they went in and fixed the hernia. That's when I had appendix out. I've had appendicitis. Does that count? I am falling apart as I approach 40 because appendicitis came as a bit of a surprise. I had tummy ache. Oh, this is bad. This is really bad. Better call a doctor. A doctor came round and did terrible things and then declared it to be appendicitis. Ooh, we'll have to whip it out. So they took me into hospital the next day, hoiked it out, woke me up, and I was sitting there in the nightie that does up at the back with the silly hat.
Why? Do you think this day and age there'd be a better thing for us to wear in hospital than the most humiliating outfit you'll ever wear? Your arse is hanging out the back. Is that just a medical joke? They haven't updated that?
No, I actually requested it.
Oh, see,
they had,
see.
They had yeah, the pyjamas, but I
like
just wanted,
chaps.
I wanted that. So I woke up and they said, so, Mr. Hammond, here's your appendix. It turns out you've had appendicitis 3 or 4 times.
Get
pretty
in.
Manly, pretty manly.
Ladies.
And then they said, and we've mended your hernia. What hernia? I didn't know I had a hernia. So I'm collecting rubbish ailments.
Doctors, though, start doing other stuff while you're under the cosh? Well, while he's under, we might as well just tidy him up
it's
anyway.
It's like mechanics, isn't it?
Yes.
We've done your brakes, lad, but we've also done your clutch. Well, I didn't know. So with me, they did my clutch as well. And then they said, until we saw him, Mr. Hampton, you've got a kidney stone, better send you in to have it sorted. Oh, I don't know if you've ever had a kidney stone.
No, it's supposed to be agony.
Yes, it's
well,
smart.
I'm not a pensioner, Richard.
Oh, mate, it smarts a bit. But it's...
Did you have to wait until it passed out?
Well, no, everybody thinks it's a
out the
final
old...
part of its journey. It's
yeah.
not. It's make if you haven't had your breakfast yet, morning, it's when it makes it from your kidney to your bladder, that little pipe.
How long will that take?
Oh, it can take a day. Well, in my
coronation, there's a big procession.
My ureter, which is the tube connecting your kidney to your bladder, mine's twisted and kinked. So it can spend like a day and a half in there. And it is unspeakably painful. So they said, Mr. Hammond, what we're going to do this time, rather than let this one go through, because the last bit of the journey, you never notice.
Yeah.
You never know about that.
Yeah, I thought that would be the very worst bit.
No. It's the first bit. So they said, what we're going to do is remove it. And rather than smash it up inside the kidney, what they do is they well, essentially, a doctor sets off up your...
That way?
Yeah, like a miner. Carrying
do
with
they
him.
Give you any kind of anaesthetic for that?
Well, as they took me in for the treatment, I said to the doctor, let me put it this way, chum, one of us had better be unconscious when this is going on. And so they said, with an actual drill and break it all up and then haul it all out.
Listen, back up a minute. Are you saying,
let me put it this way.
It goes that way, right, when it shouldn't. Only one thing goes the other way. It goes up there with a drill.
With a drill, break it up, and then they pull it out in a bag. Hey, mate, by the time they finished, I could pee a grand piano and not feel it. It was just catastrophic. It was, there's a lot of blokes in here.
Anesthetic.
Yeah, they knock you out.
You are not.
As they wheel me, yes, but they wheel me into theatre, and I did say to the doctor, one of us is going to be unconscious if you come near me with that thing, chum. Then they knocked me out, and then I woke up, oh, I am woozy, and I looked around, and I thought, I must have died, because I'm in a room full of beautiful nurses, and they were real. There were about 15 women in there, and I realised I've been in a pretty undignified position. It's not good. It wasn't.
It's the most traumatic story. I literally come out in a sweat. The thought of that and
terrible.
A tiny drill.
Yeah.
I don't mean rude to you. I mean, it could be a bigger drill.
We
don't
quite
know,
quite
Richard.
A large drill.
Yeah, yeah. A massive drill.
But they were all setting off with that over their shoulders and those little hats with lights on. Hi-ho, hi-ho.
Not the Channel Tunnel team.
Exactly right. Maybe meet another team coming the other way. It was catastrophic. I would advise against. If honestly, if anybody tells you kidney stones, I'll pass it the normal way. It's better than having... Yeah.
Now I know, because when I was looking at the book, I was thinking, because obviously people have to work long and hard, and some people don't, to come up with the catchy kind of title that leaps off the shelf and we go into Borders or Waterstones and go, oh, Richard Hammond, or is that just me? Now hearing your various very painful ailments, this is why the question's been asked in front of your book.
Well, yeah, because approaching 40, I wanted to mention, it's a big thing in my life right now.
How are you going to celebrate it or mark it?
Well, I don't. No, because, well, it's towards Christmas, and we were going to be skiing.
Yeah.
So we thought that was the answer. Yeah, skiing.
You very, very upper middle class fan, are you?
Skiing, we were. But then,
we're in Chamonix for my 40th.
Yeah, but then I twisted my ankle, and so I can't be. So I don't know.
Now you're going to be on the couch.
Yeah. It's good. What I'm going to do is
Ottoman.
Is all the on the run-up to it saying, no, I don't want to party. I don't want to say 40th birthdays. I think they are a bit sad because I know I'd end up with all my fellow 40-something mates and a load of 20-something people in the other side of the room. We're as good as them still. We can still keep going as long, can't we? I think I'm going to be sick. It's just not... It's never going to
work. I can't drink Thunderbird anymore.
Exactly. I'll show you how to chat a girl up. But she's punched me. She's actually punched me. It's not going to... It's that... There's something rather pathetic about it. So I'd said to my wife, Min, no, I don't want a 40th birthday party. Let's just let it go by. It's just another birthday. And I'm going to wake up on the day of the birthday and just be gutted that, oh, fine, my 40th birthday, we'll just let it go by, shall we, and not mark it. Thank you. So it's a lose-lose.
How do you generally feel about turning 40?
Terrible.
How can you? Your career's going well, you're alive, you survived a near-death experience, you've got a wife and kids.
Yes, but one thing all of those things have taught me is all of our lives, actually, there might be differences in all manner of ways in terms of finance or relationships or job or whatever.
Yeah.
They don't actually make that much difference. It's just at the time. That's entirely subjective. Looked at from above,
yeah.
What is the difference in how big a car somebody does or doesn't have to whether or not they use a bicycle? It really doesn't matter. What does matter is the inevitable biological reality of getting older, and that's coming as a bit
40's
of a
not that, isn't that old? You know, you see,
no, but 40's grown up, isn't it? I'm a bloke, and blokes, we all stop at...
Yeah, but we have an arrested development.
Well, yeah, we do, until somebody says, now you're 40. I stayed at 12. I reckon 12, that kind of gawky age, you know, when you're not quite a little kid anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
But neither are you a proper teenager. Yeah. Hello, and your voice keeps doing that. And you look at girls and think they're quite nice, and they don't look at you, and it's just awful.
Yeah.
I stayed at that age. Unpredictable, slightly awkward, and mostly I spend most of my time embarrassed. Nearly all of my time embarrassed.
Yeah, but I think being a man and a dad, that's our day to day. That's it for life.
That's our resting. But then all of a sudden, so this 12-year-old me bounces along, and I get up one morning, hello, and somebody says, "Hi, you're 40." What? I mean, that's properly grown up, isn't it? That's mortgage.
I think
kids,
you're still.
Dog.
I think when you're 50, that's when you have that hand on your shoulder, like, right, come on. I think when you thought, you've still got another 10 years.
No, because when you're...
Do you still have posters of, like, your idols that you had when you were a kid? Well, I have a big picture of Evel Knievel. I know you're an Evel Knievel. I did the TV documentary about him as well. My wife said, at some point, you're going to have to take those down. I said, why? She said, well, it's sort of thing a kid would have in their wall.
You're now confessing to stuff you shouldn't, because what you're doing, you're doing that thing where... You know when you have that poster on the wall of your
and
everybody
just
else is going...
What,
no,
you don't have a picture of Evel Knievel?
No, really, it's just you. It really is just you.
You don't have a picture of Evel Knievel.
No!
It's signed, my one. Well, it said on eBay, it was authenticated.
You're not impressing anyone, and it really is just you.
I guarantee there's someone else out there who's 36, right, who has a signed picture of Evel Knievel.
It's just you. That really is just you, that one. Bad luck.
I feel alone. Radio's supposed to be a connective medium.
Not right now,
now
you're right on your own. It's really not. You're so out on your own on that one. Okay. Yeah, that's just you. But anyway, it's connected with feeling old, and just it's not a mortality check. I've had one of them. That's different.
Yeah, big
this
one.
This is it's just officially grown up.
So what will you do differently now? What are you going to do? You're going to wake up 40 and what? You're going to get some Farrah pants and
Yeah,
get your slacks ready.
High.
Your dad pants.
Yep. No, nothing. I suspect it'll be fine the day after.
And then your data, but your job essentially, the main thing you do is Top Gear, where you fart us around with two other guys and get to do these fantastic things. But essentially, it's men mucking around. When men muck around, it's very childish and puerile, and that's what we all like about it.
Yeah, here's a terrifying thought then. Briefly, and it will be briefly because one of us is moving out of that particular decade, but as I move into it, I will be sharing a decade with those two.
That's not nice. That's a real wake-up call, isn't it?
No
wonder you're getting the kidney stones.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. That's probably what causes them, worry about that. So it's, yeah, that's a fairly scary thought. So it has been on my mind, and I've done many foolish things to try and put it off, all of which have made it worse. Yeah. So I kind of, well, through the book, that was my plug. What do you think I did? Through the book.
Beautifully
what
done.
Do you really think?
You never lose it. That's
as long as I don't draw attention to it now.
You
oh,
just.
Yeah, I did badly. There we go. However, I did talk about how I've kind of tried to pull it all together. So I've been cycling to try and keep fit. Fell off. But there's another story there. But
you should be allowed out of the house.
No, I am a bit of a disaster.
Well,
the falling off a bicycle, because if you cycle around London, which I always do.
Probably more dangerous than getting in a supercar and driving it very fast,
well,
Richard.
Yes, but it's the quickest way to get about the place.
Yeah, it is,
really,
but it's also
the
most dangerous.
But the quickest.
Yeah, and people would also, did you wear lycra pants? No one wants to see your backside. Okay?
No, it's always blokes as well.
It's
themselves out. Look at that!
Hardened rump. I don't want to see that for a couple of miles in the slow, chugging traffic.
I can see
it's
how you're getting your sprouts to work. I don't need to see that. Just go away. It's very unpleasant. However, I do cycle generally around town, and I did think exactly that I maybe should start taking this more seriously. Because obviously every set of traffic lights I pull over at, all I get is, well, Jez has got a Ferrari, where's yours? Yes, all right. Is that it? Yes. And so I thought, well, I did get a bit of the old lycra going on. Got myself kitted out with a proper pair of cycling shoes and all that. Oh, here we go. And I got to the first junction, which is at crossing the A4 where that Bristol Cars is. And I the lights were red. And I thought, I am ready to do that hovering thing that you see young cycle coaches.
Not the slow creep over the red line. Come on.
Where they don't put the feet down. And I thought, I am ready for this. And I'm, I've got it. And I held it, and then the lights went amber. Yes, I've impressed everybody. And I set off, and I got about four turns of the pedals and stopped pedaling dead immediately. And it just sort of coasted to a halt. What's going on? As the traffic was catching up. And then the bicycle started to lean to one side, to the left. I'm going to put my foot down, I'm going to fall off. I couldn't get my foot off the pedals. I don't have clip-on pedals or anything. I can't. And I just fell over on my side without.
Why isn't this on YouTube?
And I discovered what had happened was my fashionable cycling shoes that I'd bought. Had quite long laces, and they'd wrapped themselves during my hovering manoeuvre around the spindle of the pedal. So as I turned the pedal
away, Mr. Bean goes cycling.
It only got four turns. It was tightened up, and I fell off. That was another attempt at staving off 40.
Cool. Well, look, the book is out now. It's called Or Is That Just Me? It's by Richard Hammond. It's just me this morning now with the Evel Knievel moment. Richard, thank you very much for coming on the show. Happy birthday for your 40th.
Mm-hmm.
You've got another 10 years of prattling around. You're laughing. You're fine. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure. Lovely to come in here.
Thank you very much.